I'm Serge Kelbach. I'm working in the company in the field of biohybrid systems. We deal with innovation in this field. And in the presentation, I would like to speak about biohybridization topics, especially in living system. About some open challenges and open issues in this system. The first question, what we need to discuss, what is biohybridization in general? According to terminology, we assume that biohybridization is related to a combination between something artificial, like a technology, and natural, like a natural biology. In the human history, we had this vision of a biohybrid system almost all the time, but it changed in different historical epochs. It starts from, for instance, Golem in Middle Ages up to Frankenstein creature with very specific, let's say, capabilities, up to more modern a combination, for instance, between robot and human, or this seven of nine type of hybridization. Finally, we have more modern view. As a kind of really a tight combination between natural and artificial, and it's really difficult to recognize what is what. So finally, we cannot really say it's artificial or it's natural. In more general view, biohybridization consider biology as a kind of as a certain machinery. And of course, if there are diseases, they can be repaired. Or if there are some deficiencies, even from evolutionary point of view, we know we are not a perfect being. These deficiencies can be improved or enhanced. In the current stage, biohybrid systems, they consist of two large clusters of technologies. One is of synthetic biology. These science consider biological organisms to some extent as programmable. That in fact correspond to this field of biohybridization very well. And the second cluster is a combination between robotic, neuroscience, biointerfaces, material science, and in fact, a lot of different areas. And we also work in this second field. I would like to give some examples of what is currently achieved in the field of biohybrid systems. In the first field of synthetic biology, I mean, the whole field is really huge. I mean, it cannot be overviewed in one slide. I would like to mention here only three points that to some extent it really represent a progress in the whole field. The first one is the method of DNA editing. This method was mentioned as a method of the years in 2012. 5 years later, in 2017, there was first human genome edited in the human body. And again, 2 years later, the first genetically modified baby was born. So the main steps, key steps to some extent. And progress, I mean, in this between these steps is concentrated many different areas. In fact, refining different technologies, and one of them would really make I observe, I mean, progress in this field is a field of 3D bioprinting, printing tissues or printing organs, and several examples, for instance, artificial organs like heart. That's printed from human cells, artificial liver project or bioartificial kidneys. And here is always it's again. I repeat this. I will repeat it again and again. That in modern biohybridization, it's really difficult to say it's artificial or natural, because in even in the artificial hairs, yes, it's printed an artificial way, but using, for instance, human cells. So it's really difficult to say. The third point in artificial biology. That need to mention is a essential growth. For the startup in synthetic biology, 2 years ago raised about 1.9 billions, and in 2020 already 3 billions. It's much ahead of IT sectors, and there are multiple interesting projects. One of them, for instance, a culture at meat that from one side, of course, solves the problem of food. From another side, solve the problem of these ethical issues with animals. So, second example from this field of robotics and different areas can be given by modern prosthetic systems. Each of these devices, these leg limbs or hands, are fully autonomous robots. They have independent sensors, independent power supply, and important that all the systems are deeply integrated with bones, with muscles, and with nervous systems. Though it's the key difference with the system from previous years, in these implants, the system not only get input from nervous system and from muscles, but also reading the sensor information from robotic device and provide it back to the nervous system. So in fact, this prosthetic device provide a feeling of this missing limb. So it's a kind of really replacement for this missing organ. Another interesting example is, of course, this what recently published by Neuralink, this monkey playing ping pong by mental concentration. Neuralink says it's about 1,000 of electrodes implanted in the brain, or the goal is 1,000 electrodes. And it definitely represents a new step in this neural interfaces, what is a key technology for this field. We see here it's not only an attempt to replace some, let's say, broken organ or some diseases here, but also for extension and enhancements. And the next step is, of course, exoskeletons. We already have this development in military area or civilian area, and this can be considered as a kind of the next step for this field. This biohybridization take place not only in let's say animals and human organisms, plants are deeply involved, and for instance, we worked in this field of plant biohybridization. One of the main issue here is plants are perfect sensors because they feel not only environmental pathogen and pollutants, but also provide a kind of biological response. And by sensing this biological response, we can see the complex impact of these environmental pathogens on the biological organism. And now if we measure, for instance, electrophysiological reaction, physiological reaction of plant organism, we can better understand interaction with environment, impact of environment and biological system, and correspondingly use it for different applications. Not only single biological organism are used for biohybridization, but we use ecologies, for instance, urban ecologies. These sensors are integrated on trees in the cities, and all of them are connected to a kind of sensor network, for instance, or forest ecologies. And here are multiple research issues, for instance, balancing ecologies, integrating natural and artificial ecologies. And in this particular project, for instance, the sensor, also a smaller version of the sensor, is integrated in the tissue and receive energy from the sub of this organism. I mean, it's really integrated on the level of biochemistry. So this was a short overview. Of course, there are much more details. I would like to go to one of interesting conclusion from this cycle. What is of this biohybridization? What is not so obvious? I would like to start with some example to better understand the whole idea. We start with technology, and in this case with mobile technology. We know that system, I mean, this mobile technology starts from, I would say, 2000. In about 2010, we have a new generation of these devices with extended capabilities for cloud computing, for artificial intelligence, I mean, all this what we know now. And we see a percent of usage of mobile internet by mobile device. We see about 2014-2016 a kind of game-changing phase that most of internet is used now from mobile devices. What does it mean? I mean, in these mobile devices, we can we have access to millions of songs, thousands of movies. We have access to all written, papers, books, reports written in the history. We have excellent search engines. Even in the working environment, if we encounter some problem, we can Google it, and we can use collective knowledge to integrate this collective experience in our work. So it's that's really changed the way how we operate in working environment or in the private life. So this lead to appearance of what we call a generation of connected or networked people. They have a completely different look on the happening and the way how they should operate in different environments and in different situations. And here, important that this new generation of humans, of course, it's create a society, and the society has a new focuses, in this case, new digital societies, and this look for new technologies. And these new technologies we see last years, essential development in all kinds of wearables, for instance, smartwatch, medical implants. We can even pay with a chip implanted under the skin. And this new generation of neuro implants, what is now in developed, this this was enabled by new focus on society and specific technologies. And so we have here a cycle, technology impacting humans, human creating society, and society generating new kind of technology. And this cycle, so usually it's evolutionary cycle, and each next run of this cycle depend on the previous one. And here is important that a new generation of technology, in fact, depend how we human, because we develop this new technology, understand nature. How do we understand processes in the nature? And especially important because we deal with life, also with biological life, how do we understand the basics of biological life? So in more, let's say, in older terminology, we try to solve, of course, some problems. But we know each new generations of technologies or each new technological revolution create new problems. And in fact, balance between solved problems and new problems depend on our understanding. And in a couple of next slides, I would like to show that in fact, we are facing a lot of problems, what was in previous time attributed to, let's say, more unconventional point of view and was less focused in the conventional science, but now they are deeply in the focus of this biohybrid system development. separate between two points. First one is a non-chemical biological mechanism, and another point is more related to such really interesting issue as achieving of immortality and through biohybridization. Point of non-chemical mechanism is important. Because there's really basic stepstones or basic mechanisms in the life. And usually we say, well, all these mechanisms have a clear biochemical nature and biochemical mechanism. But in many cases, it's not really so. It's one of the first researchers, let's say, working in this field is Gurvich. And Gurvich clearly demonstrated that biophotonic phenomena are involved in the embryogenesis, in the pathogenesis, and can strongly influence the development of biological organism. And from Gurvich time up to now, it was about 50, 80 years. And we know now there's not only biophotonics, there are weak magnetic signals, electromagnetic phenomena. Currently, we also think about more quantum biology, that some quantum mechanism also influence this. What is not fully understood, and exactly this makes this area of such interest, is a weak character. For instance, in the biophotonic systems, this intensity of biophotonic emission is absolutely tiny and absolutely minimal level. Even to sense this, we need a specific sensor, we need to amplify the signal. But in the same way, we have a huge environmental illumination. And how biological system differentiate this ultra weak and ultra weak emission from this huge environmental signal, it's not absolutely clear. And the same is applied not only to photonic signals, but to all other. I mean, this ultra weak characters of these influences and a strong reaction of biological system these signals, currently it's not, let's say, fully understood. Another example that this mechanism appears not only on the cellular level but also on the biochemical level is given by this Montagnier experiment. Here is an example was performed with DNA samples. They was installed in a weak magnetic field, low frequency. And then in water that was placed closely, DNA samples by PCR test was also recognized. This experiment was replicated by several laboratories. We are in contact with two of these laboratories, but similar experiments, they was performed in different fields with different objects, probably hundreds of similar experiments. So the phenomenology definitely exists. And here again, it's a clearly non-chemical mechanism. There's a distant mechanism, and this involved several physical fields, electromagnetic fields, magnetic fields, optics as well, for transmission of some biological information. And how it's happened, it's definitely a scientific level of discussion, but how it's happened, it's currently also not really clear. There are multiple hypotheses, additional experiments, for instance, this replication in China demonstrated that there are specific additional conditions for this phenomenology. Though this discussion is still ongoing. And this one example of this phenomena on biochemical level. Third example that it's take not only on the chemistry, but also on environmental level, is can be given by this sunspots dynamics. So the first by Chizhevsky, and currently we have even this magnetobiology field and cyclical exploration of this cyclical activity field. I mean, multiple disciplines appear in this here. And the idea is that cycles in the microorganisms, they follow sunspots. dynamics of sunspots. There's always some cyclical activities. The issue is, many people say, well, it's quite well understood because it's a magnetic influence. But astrophysics says it's not only magnetic fields. There are multiple phenomena, microwave emission, corpuscular phenomena, corpuscular effects. And the point is here that, for instance, this cycles, this appears before some sunspots. Or sunspots started, but emission is not arrives at Earth, but already in the microorganism there are some changes in the dynamic according to sunspot. So this even astrophysicists says, well, understanding and especially prediction, because it's influenced not only microorganisms but almost all processes, even large social processes on the Earth, they are influenced by this dynamic of sunspots. And understanding and prediction, it's one of the grand challenges in astrophysics, though. I would like just to mention here that all these phenomena, of course, we observed them in the interfaces, by hybrid interfaces, and researchers already start to explore this in a scientific way with statistic, accumulation of statistics, with analytical methods. There are, in fact, two slides to show that we also meet all of these phenomena. The one is a non-chemical and weak effect in ionic interfaces. So if we apply here a weak emission, so really weak emission, in several cases we even perform separation of optical flow, put some barriers to shield the system from this emission and to decrease the level of emission. And important that we perform always ionic tests and biological tests in parallel. In both systems, we observe the same phenomena. So at least in ionic interfaces, we clearly see in experiments a reaction of system and these weak emissions. It's a clearly non-chemical nature, and we see how strong they influence at least rate of electrochemical reactions. In several cases, we see even quantum phenomena, for instance, proton tunneling effect is initiated by this weak emission. So in this level of smallest chemistry, electrochemistry, all these effects are quite well visible. Another example, it's more larger organism, phytosensors. And we also see here a reaction on different astronomic events on this global level. We can explore effects related, for instance, to interaction with different devices and systems. And again, this enable us to accumulate statistics, to accumulate this knowledge, this data, experimental data for their investigation. As you know, in previous time, there was clearly attributed to unconventional field, and everybody say, well, it's we don't know whether it exists. As so this experiment clearly demonstrates this phenomenology definitely exists. To remain on scientific level, we have, of course, to propose an explanation, and currently, quantum biology proposed good explanations. We think that at least two phenomena from quantum domain, it's entanglement in macroscopic system and change of quantum dynamics and electrochemistry and the level of, for instance, hydrogen bound networks, they change electrochemical reactions. And this low-level electrochemical reaction then, of course, change macroscopic values like conductivity, pH, redox potential. They change thermochemistry, and we can sense these parameters. We need, of course, some certain sensitivity in devices, but we can sense them. We can sense dynamics. We can perform experiments. And here, if we see these changes, we can impose a feedback loop. And of course, perform here a lot of different experiments. We can develop additional sensing devices and perform the development. So this was the first point about biohybridization. The second point is it's another interesting point of research related to immortality. Even I would say 20-30 years ago, immortality was science fiction. So if anybody speak about immortality, it's either esoteric or science fiction. But now we see a lot of serious research. We even define now three different ways for achieving immortality. It's absolutely serious. The one is probably started by Microsoft in real implementation. It's about putting digital footprints or digital remains or digital evidences in the kind of simulation. And the simulation can generate a response of simulated organism. For instance, here, Open Worm project, they simulate on the level of biochemistry, molecular interaction, biochemical interaction between cells of a worm. It's about 1,000 cells, 300 cells for muscles, for movement, about 90 cells for transmission of neural signals. And they can simulate movement of this worm in digital environment, the kind of simulated life forms. Microsoft says, well, if we connected enough evidence from dead people, we can even chat with these people. Looks like the person, that person is really in front of you and it's texting with you. So Microsoft even put some patents on this technology. The next way, what really currently a lot of effort is investigated is what we call biological immortality. People very seriously say that about 100 years and 100 years of active life is a realistic estimation, and even Calica, this company from Google concern, says, well, we are about 30-40% of achieved this 100 years threshold. And if, 100 years for everybody, we can definitely say, well, probably 150, 200, 300 years for people who can pay for very expensive kind of technology. And of course, implication of this huge lifespan, it's unclear. Bank of America, by the way, says that its market is huge, about 600 billions by 25. If we add from mobile devices, wearables, from robotic implants, from neural interfaces, that will be definitely one of the largest market ever in the human history. The last way for immortality, what I personally like very much, is related to quantum hypothesis. It says that biological computation take not only on the level of biochemistry, but on the quantum level. So we have in parallel running biological machinery and quantum machinery. And of course, consciousness take place in both levels. So we have biological embodiment and non-biological embodiment. And there was an old hypothesis from Penrose and Hameroff. They say, well, that's take place in both, let's say, levels. And currently we have a lot of experimental evidences in last 3-4 years that says indeed we have quantum machinery behind biological computation, and in fact this field of quantum biology grows now. And the point here is if this biological machinery die, that probably quantum machinery still remain, and we still have a quantum consciousness, or to some extent this is difficult to say what is remain, but to some extent this quantum, let's call it quantum consciousness. And in discussion there are several ways, either it's really kind of through quantum way, through, let's say, different worlds or different universum, within one of this universum person still alive, or it's really more in the way of quantum soliton, that through macroscopic entanglement this computational quantum computational engine is still still persist at least for some times. But this more or less in the hypothesis level, what I observed in this field, there is a interest for researching all techniques from Tibet, from China, from Japan, from Korea, from India. The techniques, they intend achieving this immortality. And they clearly say that almost everybody is immortal. And there is an interest to explore these techniques by modern methods. And in fact, this is by hybridization, because we put sensing devices on a living organism. And they collect a lot of data. And here, for instance, from Tuma Yoga, from Qigong, Tai Chi, Qigong, Reiki, a lot of different techniques and their exploration. And assumptions, like I say, that probably in this way, as using this this classical techniques, this immortality could be also achieved. So it's three different ways. So finally, to conclude this talk, we see, of course, a clear opportunity to solve health problems, to increase quality and duration of active life through this enhancement by hybridization. Important is also that by hybridization of ecosystem, that enable us to balance ecosystem, this damage that that civilization introduced to natural systems, to natural ecologies, that need to be balanced, is an urgent need, and biohybridization can really contribute to solution of this problem. We also say it's a huge market, absolutely huge market. It means that will be definitely innovation companies, will be capital, that will be scientific research, and we will see products, so cyclically improved products on the market. For this, we need a better understanding of life, better understanding of these mechanisms, especially of this topic, what was usually attributed to more, let's say, unconventional, properly to some extent, esoteric, because they really give a new understanding of life. And we see, even now, we see a confirmation of this hypothesis in experimental data. We can attribute this data probably more to quantum biology now, is a current understanding. And here we need also to say that some effects could be unpredictable, what is especially related to immortality. Okay, then I finish with this presentation. Many thanks for your attention.